This is the ongoing tension between state and religion in the Middle East. How we gonna define future Palestine? And this animosity, deep animosity between Fatah and Hamas, it's not just mere political struggle, as we tend to say. There are two totally different future visions on how Palestine should look like. And the gap between Hamas and Fatah is still there. And no conciliation agreement is going to just cover the gap or have kind of a... It's unbridgeable, I mean, this is what I would say, at this stage at least. So I do think that we're going to have a lot of... Yes, please.
Professor Rabi, very much appreciate your analysis and vision. But I note that voices like yours in Israel are outside the political realm, outside the Knesset. And change will not come about till people like you, I don't know, is it that you don't want to get dirty by going into the political process? Or what is it that's keeping the really outstanding visionaries and analysts in Israel from making the changes that we all know need to be made?
I mean, you are right. Listen, first of all, I am more than welcome in the Knesset, I can tell you. I mean, they're just a member of Knesset, and even ministers actually do ask me and my colleagues in the university to have our opinions about things whenever there is a need. But I can tell you, the problem is not politicians or statesmen. The problem is the way the Israeli political system is forged. I mean, that is a very complex system where, I mean, I'm really sorry to say that, but a prime minister, from the early days of his prime ministership, I mean, what he has to do is just to, I would say, tailor kind of a coalition that would be much comfortable to his day-to-day dealing. So he is dealing with tactics, not with strategy. And it is on and on, back and forth. And you're going to get it from the ultra-Orthodox, you're going to get them from the right-wingers, you're going to get it from here and there. So it's not necessarily they do not think that way. They do think that way, but they cannot turn it into a real political scheme. So we are also saying, and this is something that is being said in Israel loud and clear, we have to change the political system. We don't want this.
I don't want to interrupt, but I've just come back from there, and I've listened to both sides because of the group that I was over with.
Both sides of?
Both sides, Knesset and Governor Dove. I went to see Fuki, nickname, Bedouin villages all over. And both groups seem to keep saying that they feel President Obama has to get involved.
But
I didn't say I was blown away.
But President Obama said it loud and clear.
Yes.
The United States is kind of a source of inspiration.
Yes.
The United States is not the engine anymore.
True.
We have to know that. And statesmen, I mean politicians in Israel say, and I was told, so why the Americans are not going to just, I mean, let the Americans renew or restart the whole thing. And they don't get that Obama is working differently. America's Obama is kind of a superpower which behaves totally different from what Middle Easterners had in the 20th century. It's a source of inspiration. Now, you heard these and the others. I mean, frankly, you know, I mean, that's the problem, if I may say so, you know, with democracy. I would like to quote one of my Egyptian friends who talked to me actually 2 weeks ago when I asked him actually, so what is your take? What do Egyptians wish or want? And he said, you tell me what Egyptians wish or want. When I asked you actually several years ago what Israelis wish or want. You said, listen, in Israel you have 8 million prime ministers. You can't actually ask that kind of a question. Well, let me tell you that, he says, we have 80 million presidents, 80 million presidents in Egypt nowadays, and this is part of the whole thing. In Egypt, everybody nowadays knows better than anybody else what should be done in Egypt. Many, you know, everybody would like to have a party of his own. But this is the part of the whole process. So I don't think that this is the main issue. I think that what we have to understand is that many Middle Eastern states and statesmen haven't got the, I think that they should just come to the conclusion that, at least when it comes to America's Obama, I mean, Obama is working in a different way. I think that some of them took it to the other direction, saying that, well, what the case of Hosni Mubarak proves is that you can't count on the United States. You have to come up with kind of a more balanced strategy, because if you would like to end up with Mubarak, you should just stick to the United States the way Mubarak did it. I think that we are, again, I mean, this is also something which is in the process. Yes,
last question, because I know the professor has another appointment.
Oh, okay. First of all, to disagree with the woman who cut in, because I have spent a lot of time in Israel. I also have friends and relatives who are members of the Knesset, who are presently members of the Knesset, and I will say that my politics are way left of center in the United States and in Israel. I used to be involved with Meretz USA and still have a lot of friends there, just so that you know where I'm coming from. At the same time, I agree with you on that there are so many different opinions, yet all morning long you have been talking about Israel wants, Israel believes. And I would question whether you can speak about, any more than you can speak about one spokesman, as you just said, for the United States. But there is one issue that you didn't touch on at all, and that is, I think, a key issue, which is the issue of the settlements in the occupied territories and the continuing building of those settlements, which I think almost all the sides, and even some members of Likud have said, maybe have to stop. But yet Netanyahu continues that going, and actually, well, I don't know whether Obama pushed him to do more, or whether whatever went on between the two of them.
I think it's not Obama. I think that Netanyahu realizes that he should come up with something, that he cannot stick to the saying that if Hamas is in, I am out. This is just not enough.
No, but he has always continued with the building of the settlements in the occupied territory and doesn't seem to be backing off on that. And it is my understanding that when you mentioned all the key issues, that is one of the key issues and one of the starting points, maybe even more than the 67 lines or anything else.
Yes, but I agree with you. But, you know, I mean, if we would like to delve into details here, I think that we need another presentation to deal with, because this is the buildings of the details of the Berkeley peace treaty or the negotiating table. I would say that Netanyahu said, and don't underestimate that. We're going to have 67, and he even talked about settlements that will be left behind. You know, this is something. This is something.
Even if it is just a tactic, this is something that it goes beyond imagination when it comes from somebody who comes from the right wing, and he is. I agree with you. There would be a lot of problems with that. But I'm pretty sure that if, again, 48 files, refugees, are going to get kind of, a solution, and the solution should be there. Saudi Arabia should pay for that. The quartet, the European quartet should pay for that. Many Palestinians will have or will get citizenship in Syria, Lebanon, whatever. Few and far between will get back to Israel in order to make this symbol something that the Palestinians could live with. But this would be it. 67, I can tell you, if we're going to get there, there would be a consensus in Israel. I mean, I'm talking about the public, not about Netanyahu. I think that we will find a solution. If that would be the problem, I mean, the settlements, we will find a solution. You would like me to say that it would kind of a smooth transition? No. The news is that in Israel you have also lunatics. We're going to have even a kind of an internal civil war, I mean, a tiny civil war. There won't be kind of a smooth thing. But we have to take harsh decisions. And if you are think you know that Netanyahu is being depicted by some ultra-Orthodox as the next Rabin, and they have made kind of a funeral to Netanyahu saying that he is not allowed to say what he said, take it into account and just, I mean, Netanyahu will not be the prime minister forever in Israel. That's true, I can tell you that. And the Israeli public would like to have a peace treaty with the Palestinians, because everybody knows that this is a must. What we need is somebody to take us there, not only Israeli leader, Palestinian leaders and Arab leaders. So it has to be kind of a regional effort. I do believe that in the future we're going to have that. Now what I see is kind of a situation which makes it much more difficult, because the Palestinians are divided. I think that we have those upheavals in the Arab world. The United States is different, is acting in a different manner that it used to, we used to have here. Let the Middle East digest the current developments. I think that when we get in the beginning of next year, say 2012, after having that September thing, I think we're going to have some fresh openings. I hope we're going to have that.
That is a great moment to close this. I want to thank you so much. That was so interesting.
Thank you, and I just want to let you know that we in the Dayan Center actually are working on that day and night, believe me. We have a lot of work to do, and we would love actually have you as our subscribers, because we have a lot of stuff we have come up with. And Heidi, if you could just, you know, just give this card to everybody, and that would be great. Yeah, please. Thank you.
Thank you
very much.